Okay, so yeah, so let me just remind you in 2 seconds what we saw yesterday. So I just wrote down here the sort of basic definitions that I gave yesterday. So those sort of regularity structure was basically a graded vector space with some group action that has some kind of lower triangular structure on it. And then a model for regularity structure essentially consisted of two pieces. So there was a map pi x, which to every point associates the sort of Taylor polynomial, if one wants, based at that point. And then there were these group elements, gamma x, y, that essentially take an expansion around the point and re-expand it around another point. And they were assumed to satisfy these consistency relations. And these analytical bounds, which are just essentially natural if you have in mind the example of the usual Taylor expansions. And then once we have such a model, we can define the analog of a space of Hilbert continuous functions. And so I call that space D gamma. And it's defined by a bound like this, which in the case, again, where these are just the usual Taylor polynomials, it just boils down to the usual C gamma functions. Okay? And we've seen yesterday that if you happen to have a product on T that satisfies certain natural conditions, so basically the only condition it needs to satisfy is that homogeneities add up when you multiply things, and that when you re-expand a product, it's the same as first multiplying and then re-expanding is the same as first re-expanding and then multiplying. Okay? And then under these conditions, we had a rule that said, but well, if you take two of these d gamma elements and you just form the pointwise product, then you're again in one of these d gammas, and there was a identity for the gamma that you obtain. And the main abstract result, in a way, was the fact that as soon as you have an element in one of these d gammas for gamma strictly positive, it does describe a unique distribution up to somehow errors of order gamma at each point. Okay, so there is a unique distribution that's associated to an element like this. And so what I want to discuss now for a little bit is how do you describe convolution with something like the heat kernel in this framework? Okay, so because that's what we needed in order to formulate our fixed point argument. So what we want now is an operation that corresponds to, say, convolution with some kernel K. And you should think of K as something like the heat kernel. Now, since for the moment everything was set up as a very local theory, and I want to keep it local so that, for example, treatment of things like boundary conditions and so can be done completely separately. And so what I'm going to assume is that K has compact support. And now, obviously, the heat kernel doesn't have compact support, but it's not a problem because the only difficulty from describing the convolution with the heat kernel comes from the fact that it has a singularity at the origin, right? Or typically, the Green's function of any sort of elliptic or parabolic operator is smooth everywhere, but it has a singularity at the origin. And so you can always write it as a compactly supported bit that contains the singularity plus a completely smooth bit, which in the case of the heat kernel also has decay that you control extremely well. Okay? And then the convolution with a smooth bit, there's absolutely no problem defining it, right? Because you can always, if you take any distribution, you convolve with something smooth, you get something smooth. And then you can lift it into any of these d gammas, provided that your regularity structure does actually contain the usual Taylor polynomials. Okay? So the smooth part can always be somehow treated completely separately. And so we only need to define the convolution with the singular part. Okay. Now, the philosophy here is that, so remember, for multiplication is really a pointwise operation. And so what we saw is that, as a consequence, you can define at the level of these jets, or sort of Taylor expansions. Well, the Taylor expansion of a product is simply the product of the Taylor expansions. Okay? And that's essentially true whenever you have a local operation. Right? So like the derivative, the Taylor expansion of the derivative of a function is the derivative of the Taylor expansion. Okay? So if you have a pointwise, purely local operation, then you can perform it just at the level of the pointwise, at the level of the jet, at the level of the Taylor expansion. Now, convolution with a kernel that has a singularity is obviously not a purely local operation. But one should think of it as being almost a local operation, okay? In the sense that, you know, K is going to look like something like this. So then it has compact support, so it's sort of zero outside of some ball. It has a singularity here. And the singularity is at zero. Okay? Now, if the support here were very small, then it would be almost a local operation, right? Because convolution with something that has very small support only depends on what happens in a very small neighborhood. Okay? And well, of course, you can always write this. You could have cut it off at any point, right? You could have cut it off at a very small neighborhood. You can always write it as something very local plus something smooth. It's just that the smooth bit gets less and less smooth when you do that. And so morally, you should think of convolution with a kernel like this as being a local operation modulo smooth bits. Okay? So it's somehow almost local, but not quite local. But as far as the singular bits are concerned, it's local. Yeah? And so what this suggests is that we should, again, be able to implement it essentially as a pointwise operation at the level of the jet, or at the level of the local sort of Taylor expansion, but then plus something more complicated and non-local happening at the level of the usual monomial, okay, the part of the expansion that would correspond to the usual Taylor polynomials. And so what we're going to assume from now on, that we have a subspace T bar in T, which consists of the usual Taylor polynomials. Okay? So we assume that we do have the usual Taylor polynomials at our disposal. So if you want, there is a subspace T bar, which is simply the, if you want, here abstract polynomials in D commuting variables. And so if you want, T bar is generated by, it's just a linear span of, you know, usual kind of monomials. And we assume that the model acts in the usual way on this. So pi x of x to the k is actually a function. And it's the function y minus x to the k. Okay, so that's what the usual Taylor polynomials are in this context. Okay, so we assume that we have the usual Taylor polynomials at our disposal, but then we might have other stuff. Okay. And now it turns out that from the sort of point of view of the algebraic part, it's going to be very convenient also to assume that the kernel K is such that if you integrate K against the polynomial, you get zero, provided that the degree of Q is not too large. Okay, so degree of Q less than some fixed value R, and you need to take R big enough for the problem that you're considering. So in our case, you take R equal 2, and that's enough. Okay. So that just turns out to be a convenience. So Q is a polynomial here. And of course, since we think of K as not being the whole heat kernel anyway, but just a singular part, you know, we can always extract this, we can always mess around with it in such a way that this is true, right? So this is not really a condition, because all it means is, well, you make sure that K has this property, and whatever you mess around with K, you just add it back into the remainder, which is smooth anyway, and that's treated separately, okay? So you can always impose this. That's not a problem. And now what we're going to assume also is that K, in some sense, really looks like this. Okay, so in the sense that it has a singularity, it's smooth everywhere except at the origin, and at the origin it has a kind of well-defined singularity. Okay? Now I'm not going, well, okay, one way of formalizing this, the easiest way of formalizing this, is to actually say that K is equal, can be written as a sum for n greater than 0 of Kn's. And the Kn, so you decompose, you essentially decompose it into bits at smaller and smaller scale. And the Kn is supported in the ball of radius 2 to the minus n. Okay, so the support of Kn is in the ball of radius 2 to the minus n around the origin. And all the Kn's are smooth, okay, so which immediately tells you that K is smooth everywhere except possibly at the origin. And we assume that the Kn's, or the Kn's and their derivatives, satisfy the following bounds. So there exists some beta positive, and in our case, beta is really 2, so that's how much regularity you gain from convolution with the kernel, such that if you take the, say, the kth derivative of Kn, and you look at the L infinity norm of that, then you want a bound of the following type. So if the Kn's were scaling like a delta function and there was no derivative at all, then you would have something like 2 to the n times the scaling dimension of your space. Okay, so I write d here, but it's really the scaling dimension where time counts double, right? So you would have your space dimensions and then time counts double. So that's what you would have if you just had a delta type scaling for the L infinity norm. Whenever you take a derivative, you lose essentially a factor 2 to the minus n, because the thing is supported in something of radius 2 to the minus n. And so you would have here a plus the length of the multi-index k times n. And then what we assume is that it's actually better than that, right? So this is what you would expect if the kn scaled a bit like a delta function, okay? But if you convolve with something that scales like a delta function, you know that you gain nothing in terms of regularity. You essentially get the same thing back. And so what we want is we want to gain beta worth of regularity. So that means that here we impose that we have a minus beta n. Okay? And this should be true, again, for all k's, you know, not too big. So you don't assume that this is true for every k. You assume that it's true for k less than something. In our case, I don't know, 2 or 4 or 5 or something like that. Okay, in the case of the heat kernel, you can actually make it smooth, and so a bound like this is true for every k. Okay, and for the heat kernel, this is true with beta equal 2. Okay, you can decompose the heat kernel in this way. It's very easy. And it's true for pretty much any, you know, the Green's function of pretty much any elliptic or parabolic differential operator with constant coefficients can be has a decomposition like that, and it's usually very easy to see what beta is. Yeah. Okay, so that's going to be the assumptions on K. And so now what we want is we would want an operator, say curly K, that that acts on one of these d-gamma spaces. Okay? And we would want it to have the following properties. So on the one hand, we expect to have something like a Schauder estimate. And Schauder estimate says that if you convolve something which has regularity alpha with a kernel like that, you obtain something that has regularity alpha plus beta. Okay? You gain beta worth of regularity. And so we would want the k to go from d gamma into d gamma plus beta, right? And that's already what I mentioned towards the end yesterday, that if we had something like this, we could basically close our fixed point argument. And then we would want the operator curly k to really represent convolution with that kernel k. Okay? So what does it mean, representing convolution with the kernel k? Well, it means that if you apply curly k to an element in one of these d gammas, and then you apply this reconstruction operator, so you look at what's the actual distributional function that this really corresponds to, then you would want to get the same as first applying the reconstruction operator. So now you get a distribution, and then you convolve that distribution with k, which you can always do. Okay, it might give you another distribution, but you can always do it. Yeah? And so you would want to have this, right? If you have this identity, then this operator really represents convolution with k. Okay. And now what I mentioned earlier is that we would expect the operator curly k to be sort of almost local, in the sense that we'd expect it to be non-local only as far as the part with the usual Taylor polynomials is concerned. It should be essentially a local operator for the other parts. Okay? And it turns out that you can do that. Okay? So you can do that, provided, again, that that this structure is essentially rich enough to support the objects that you need in order to build this operator. Okay, it's like for the product. So you can multiply these things, well, provided that you actually have a product up there with the right properties, and your model extends to this whole space. Okay, so it's the same story here. So what you want, so you assume that you have a, in the same way as for the product, we assumed that we simply had a product given here. What we assume is we assume that we have this local operation, which we're going to then sort of interpret as convolution with k, but for the rough bits. So we assume that we have an operator I that goes from t to t. And now, what are the properties that it should have? So remember, for the product, the natural property was that the homogeneities of a product should add up. Here, the natural property, given that we'd want this, or given the Schauder estimates, the natural property would be that if you apply I to something of homogeneity alpha, you should get something of homogeneity alpha plus beta, okay, for this, with this beta here. Okay, so alpha plus 2 in our case. Okay, so we would want that it maps T alpha into T alpha plus beta. And then for the product, which was a purely local operation, we had this property that it essentially commutes with the action of that group. Okay? And now here, what we expect, since we expect it to be essentially local but modulo the Taylor polynomials, what this translates into is that you would want this operator here to not quite commute with the action of G, but almost commute with it, in the sense that if you take any gamma in G and you look at I gamma minus gamma I applied to any element tau, then you want this to lie to be an element of T bar, so of the usual Taylor polynomial. Okay, so that means, right? So this is somehow the abstract version of the statement that it commutes with the action of G modulo the Taylor polynomials. Okay, so if you look at the commutator between I and any element of G, so here gamma is any element of G, you get something that always maps you into the Taylor polynomials. Okay. And then the third natural assumption, which is in view of this, is that it maps T bar to 0. Okay, so this is really just the sort of reflection of this property here, which then turns out to be convenient. Okay. And so now, once you have an object like this, now what you would want is you would want this guy to really represent convolution with K. Okay? And so this is something that you don't impose at the level of this algebraic structure. It's something that you impose at the level of the model. Okay, so you want to somehow relate the given an element tau in your T, you would want to relate somehow the model, the pi x of tau, with pi x of I of tau. Okay. And now this is what we call an admissible model. Okay, so given such a kernel, an admissible model is one where pi x of tau and pi x of I of tau relate to each other in the right way. Okay. And now the natural thing that one would guess would be that pi x of I tau should just be k convolved with pi x tau, right? So that would be the first guess. But now if you impose this, you realize that it doesn't quite work because you see, suppose this is some element of already positive homogeneity, or it doesn't really matter. And then suppose that I of tau becomes of really positive homogeneity. Okay? Now, just because this guy vanishes around x to certain order doesn't tell you anything about this guy, right? This guy certainly doesn't need to vanish around x to any order at all, right? It will just have some value at x. So if you define it in this way, then you're going to immediately break these analytical bounds. Right? So this bound is going to be broken straight away. And so this is not a good definition. What you should do instead is you should essentially subtract the Taylor expansion at the right order. Right? You would say, well, this guy doesn't vanish to the right order at x, but now maybe it actually has a Taylor expansion up to that order at x, and if it does, then I can just subtract that Taylor expansion. Okay? And it turns out that it always does. Okay? So the correct way of defining it is you want to impose that this is this minus actually some Taylor expansion at x of that guy. Okay, and so I call j of x of tau its Taylor expansion, and that's just given by, so j of x of tau would just be given by the sum of x to the k over k factorial, k less than the homogeneity of tau plus beta of, well, the Taylor expansion of this guy. So it's the kth derivative of k of x minus y pi x tau of dy. Right? So this is just, these here are just the Taylor coefficients of this guy at x formally. And now you would say, well, hold on. I mean, this guy is a distribution. I can always test it against smooth test functions, but this guy is not smooth at all, right? So it's not guaranteed in principle that I can actually test this guy against that guy. But now the way you should interpret this is really as having kn here and having a sum over n outside. And now for kn, there's no problem. And so all you need to check is whether the sum converges. And then it turns out that, you know, if you put together the definition here and these definitions, these bounds here, you realize that actually this for k strictly less than the homogeneity of tau plus beta, that's exactly the condition that you need to guarantee that this sum always converges. Okay, so this makes perfect sense for every k up to the homogeneity of tau plus beta. And then there's a theorem that tells you that if this guy satisfies the analytical bounds over there, and you define this guy in this way, then this guy satisfies again these analytical bounds, but for homogeneity alpha plus beta rather than alpha. Okay? And so with this definition, now it's consistent at least. Okay? So this gives you a way of defining things which is consistent with these definitions here. Okay? Sorry? Well, the k is a multi-index. K has to be positive. Right. So if, for example, if this guy by itself is already negative, then you subtract nothing. Okay. Yeah, so k is an integer multi-index. So if there's nothing less than that, it's just an empty sum. OK. So now, so maybe let me write it here. Okay, so it turns out that if you have an admissible model, so if you have a model that satisfies this identity for an operator I with these properties here, then it's possible to construct a curly K which has these properties. So it satisfies a Schauder estimate. And it satisfies this identity here. So it really represents convolution with k. Okay? And there's actually an explicit formula for it. So k applied to f at x is given by what? Well, there's a local part and there's a non-local part. So the local part is just given by apply I to f of x. Right? So I is this operator here, which is supposed to somehow represent convolution with k. But now this is a purely local operation, right? So you just pointwise at every point x, you just shift the coefficients. Essentially, you just shift the coefficients in your expansion by one slot. Right? And now you have to do something else. So first, what you do is you kind of undo this subtraction here. So you add back here this j of x, f of x, but that's still a purely local thing. And so the last thing you have to do is you have to add a global term. And that term looks very similar to this. So you have an integral of kth derivative of k of x minus y. But what it gets integrated against here is essentially is the remainder term for the reconstruction operator. Okay, so we have this reconstruction operator RF, and then you subtract pi x f of x, which is essentially the jet, if you want, at x, and you integrate this guy against that. So you integrate this guy in y, you integrate it against this guy here, and the sum goes over k less than gamma plus beta. Okay, where gamma is the gamma, is this gamma here. And for essentially the same reason as here, this is well defined. Okay, so it should again be interpreted as a sum over n of this integral with kn. And now for each n, this is a perfectly smooth test function. You can test against this distribution. And the theorem, the reconstruction theorem, gave you a bound that said, well, test this against the localized test function. You get something of order gamma. And it turns out that this bound is exactly what you need to guarantee that this makes sense for every k less than gamma plus beta. Okay, in exactly the same way as here, the bounds on pi x guarantee that this makes sense for every k less than the homogeneity of tau plus beta. Okay, so this is always well defined. There's no problem making sense of this. And, well, the theorem is that if you define it in this way, then it has these two properties. Okay, and so that's really the non-trivial theorem in this whole business. Okay, so, if you define this operator k like that, on the one hand, it has this property, which is relatively easy to check. So if you remember that we had this identity that if everything consists of smooth functions, then Rf of x is just pi x f of x evaluated at x, which makes sense if everything is made of continuous functions. And so if you plug this in here, it's not too difficult to you see that somehow everything kind of cancels out, and the only thing that remains is the k equals 0 term of this, of the last term here. This guy cancels out with this guy here. And so it's relatively easy to convince yourself that it does the right thing, at least if everything consists of continuous functions. Okay, so it has this identity. And of course, there would be tons of other definitions that will give you something that satisfies this identity. But this definition also gives you this gain in regularity. Okay, and that's a non-trivial fact because it's, as a function, I mean, the function that this guy represents or the distribution that this guy represents, of course, isn't regular at all. Okay? But still, you have a description of it up to order gamma plus beta, which is given by this formula. Okay. So let me see now how do we more concretely apply this whole business to the problem that we're interested in. Okay. Yes? Yeah. Right, so what you do is you actually, so you build, you see, you build your, so that's what, okay. So in some sense, that's what I was about to show, actually. Okay. So maybe in, if in 10 minutes your question still holds, then you should. okay, so let me erase. But you see, here, at the. Right. But you see, the script. The script I, in a way, the I, you can build the structure a priori without knowing anything about the kernel K, except the fact that it will gain beta worth of regularity, right? I mean, this is not an analytic object. This is just, these guys are just finite dimensional vector spaces. It's just some linear map that tells you how to shift shift coefficients around, right? Well, okay, so what you do is you build this space here. You essentially build that space recursively in the following way. So you say the equation that I want to solve. So first what you do is, well, you have your Taylor polynomials. Okay, so this one, you have to start from that. You need those. Right. Then what we're going to do is we introduce an additional symbol that I call capital Xi, which is going to represent the noise. Okay, so what we want to do is we want to reformulate our equation as a fixed point problem, which will now be curly K applied to minus phi cube plus the noise. And the noise, we're going to just represent it by a basis vector of t. Okay, so what we do is we simply postulate there's a symbol capital Xi, which we say belongs to t, which we postulate to have the homogeneity corresponding to space-time white noise. So in this case, would be basically minus 5 half or a little bit below because you want supremum bounds and so you always lose a little bit. Okay, so you postulate that you have a symbol like this. And you're going to say that, well, the pi x applied to Xi will just be your noise Xi. Okay? And this, you can do it whether this is smooth or actually space-time white noise. Okay? And now, you see, you know that K will be given by I and then plus stuff involving Taylor polynomials. Okay? And now what you do is you simply add all the symbols you need in order to make sense of this. So what you say, well, OK, I have my symbol Xi. I certainly need the symbol I of Xi. Right? So I just add it. So I have I of Xi. And that one, I know what's the homogeneity that it should have. It should have two beta. And so it should be minus 1 half, minus kappa. Right, so now these are just basis vectors, right? And so you just add basis vectors one by one, and you give them these names. And of course, the names reflect already how you're going to define the map I, right? So obviously, I applied to this gives you this one, right? So that's why you call it like that. And you postulate in which the grading, right? So now you see, well, you know, the phi is going to have I of Xi appearing in its description. It will also have, for example, constants appearing in its description. So in the phi cube, there's going to be I of Xi square, and I of Xi cube, right? So you're going to need also I of Xi square, and that will have homogeneity minus 1 minus 2 kappa because of our rule that homogeneities add up. And you will want I of Xi cube, which will have homogeneity minus 3 half minus 3 kappa. Right? And then you have I of all of these guys. Right? And so you add them. Right? So you have I of, say, I of Xi square or I of Xi cube. And that's going to belong to, well, 2 beta. So there would be a plus a half minus 3 kappa, right? Et cetera, et cetera. Okay, so you just simply add all these symbols into your space. And therefore, if you want, by definition, now you can make sense of these operations because you've just added all the symbols that you need in order to make sense of these operations, right? And what you see is that if you look at the homogeneities, they kind of tend to increase, right? So there's this guy is the one with lowest homogeneity. Then the next worst guy is this one with homogeneity minus 3 half. Then there's this one with minus 1. Turns out that when you continue this game, there's nobody else appearing with homogeneity minus 1 or minus 3 half. So, right? So things actually keep on improving. Okay? And so what this shows you is that when you play this game, you can actually truncate. At some point, you can truncate because you say, well, at the end of the day, I want to formulate my fixed point problem in d gamma for gamma, whatever, bigger than 1 or 3 half or something like this. And so I don't really need anything of homogeneity bigger than that because I just want to be able to formulate the fixed point problem in that space. And so then since I only need things of homogeneity less than, say, 3 half, well, I can simply truncate this thing. I say, well, whenever I have something of homogeneity bigger than that appearing, I just throw it away. And then I end up with perfectly nice finite dimensional vector space, right? And so now my T is perfectly nice and finite dimensional. It has finitely many of these indices here. And each of the T alphas is finite dimensional. It just contains a few of these expressions, right? And so now what you see, before going a little bit more into details, I want to also change notation, because you see here the notation starts getting pretty cumbersome very quickly. And so what you want to introduce some shorthand. And here there's kind of nice graphical shorthand, which is to say, well, you say the psi is a dot, and integration is a line going down, okay? And multiplication is just joining things by their roots. So I of psi square, you would represent it just by this. I of psi cube, you would represent it by this. I of psi cube, you would represent it by this, et cetera. Okay? They are some sort of Feynman diagram type objects. Okay, so now I'm going to use this representation for the basis vectors just because it's shorter. Okay, but it's kind of clear how you do the translation from one to the other one. Yeah. And okay. Now I told you how to define the space T. Yes. Down. Right, so that will, I of psi would be this. With the, yeah, so there are dots here, if you want.
Okay.
There should be several, can be several, right, that one has three psi's. No. So the psi is basically at the leaves. Yeah. So now I told you how to define this space T. I didn't tell you how to define G, right? So I'm not going to go into the details of how to define G, but essentially it's implicitly defined by this kind of rule, because you know you kind of see what's going to happen. So G tells you what happens when you change that value x. Right? So on the one hand, if you assume that you know how it changes when applied to tau, then you already know what happens here. And then here, when you change the value x, well, essentially you have to shuffle around these coefficients. You have to replace these coefficients at the point x for the same coefficients at a different point. Okay? And so the group G is essentially going to be consists of a group of operations that perform that kind of substitution, right? So there is a, you know, there is an algebraic way of describing it, but I'm not going to go into details because there wouldn't be so much point to it. Now, the important thing is that it turns out that as far as the group G is concerned, or if you want, as far as the gammas are concerned, it's completely determined basically by these coefficients here, okay, for all values of x. And these coefficients are computed from the pi. Okay? So it turns out that in the case of the type of structures we consider here, if you know pi, you know g, you know the gamma xy's. Okay? So in this particular case, the pi's completely determine the gammas via this identity over there. Okay? It's not true in general. Okay? So there are structures where the gammas are not necessarily determined by the pi, but for this particular structure, it's the case. Okay? That if you know the pi, you know the gamma. And so I basically only need to describe the pi's because the gammas take care of themselves. And furthermore, it turns out, you see, it's always true that gamma xy can be factorized as some fx times fy inverse. Okay, so this is true just by virtue of this identity. You could, for example, take fx equal gamma x0 or something like that, right? Then this would be true. Now, in this particular case, it turns out that there is a nice way of describing the fx's in terms of the pi's, which is not of the form gamma x0, but which is essentially just something built from these coefficients, okay? But doesn't make reference to a reference point, okay? So there is a nice way of describing this fx. And then what you have is that, you see, pi x fx, because of this identity here, pi x fx doesn't depend on x, okay? And so you so I can call this guy a boldface pi. Yeah? So that's now just one single linear map from T into space of distributions. And it turns out that that one completely describes the model, okay? So in this particular case, once you know this guy, you can compute the fx, and then you can compute the gamma xy, and then you can go back and compute the pi x's, okay? So you can, once you know this single linear map, you know everything. And in our case, how do we define this map? So there's a canonical way. Given any smooth realization psi of the noise, there's a canonical way of building this map, which is very simple. Okay, so if psi is smooth, okay, then what we do is we say, well, so for this guy, we just say pi psi is psi, okay? And then every other, and of course for the Taylor polynomials, it's just given by the Taylor polynomials, just by polynomials. And now every other element of T can be obtained by just products and composition with I. Okay, that's essentially how we built T recursively. It's by the operations that appear here, and the only operations that appear are products and acting on by I. And so all we have to do is say how this guy behaves under multiplication and acting by I. And so acting by, at the level of this linear map pi, boldface pi, acting with I really corresponds now to convolution with K. Okay. And the product, well, for the canonical lift, we just say, take as the product the usual product, which we can do for smooth functions. Okay, so for smooth function, we just postulate that this guy, when acting on a product, just gets multiplied. Okay? And it turns out that this is consistent with the whole, all of these, I mean, so there's a theorem, if you want, is that if psi is smooth, and you build the pi in this way, and then you go back and you build the fx's and the pi x's, then you obtain a model which satisfies all of these bounds and furthermore satisfies these identities. Okay, so the whole thing is set up in such a way that it's compatible with this way of specifying this one single linear map. Okay? Right. So well, so this is a completely pathwise construction, right? So I say for a smooth function, I know how to do this. So you should think of it as being the psi epsilon, for example, right? So you regularize your noise, for example. But here, this is something which is, it's a completely deterministic construction at this stage. Sure, everything, exactly. So you're right, so of course, and the point is what you want to do now is you want to say, well, is there a way of making these guys converge as epsilon goes to zero in the topology given by these analytical bounds? Okay. Yes, that's right. Yeah. So the whole algebraic bit doesn't depend on epsilon at all. but the model depends on epsilon, right? And the gammas depend on epsilon as well, because they are computed for, they are essentially these coefficients here, and there's the pi appearing here, which itself depends on epsilon, right? So the model, both the pi and the gamma, they depend on epsilon. And now the aim of the game is to say, well, can you make it converge? And of course, if you just do this, it won't converge. Okay, because here the first non-trivial guy you get, this one, now represents k convolved with psi epsilon squared, right? And this, you know, it's not going to converge as epsilon goes to zero. Okay. And so now what you do is you ask yourself, can I find a consistent way of renormalizing this guy? And so what does it mean here? Well, I would want to, you see, I don't have that many operations at my disposal. So all I have at my disposal is basically the different components of that guy. So the only way that I can build, and for given epsilon, the only natural way that I can build some model with that smooth noise is by doing this canonical way of lifting it. And so now I have this canonical model, if you want, at fixed epsilon. And I would want to build a new model from that. And I want to do this construction in such a way that the new model, on the one hand, still satisfies all of these analytical bounds and is admissible in the sense that was written over there. And so that the new one converges to a limit as epsilon goes to zero. Okay? And so pretty much the only way, so you have this linear map from this space T to distributions, pretty much the only way that you can build a new one from an old one is to perform linear combinations of the components. Okay? So now what you do is you give yourself a map M from T to T, and you build a model pi M, which is just given by pi, composed with m. Now, if you have a general map from t to t, you're going to completely break all the properties of the model, right? And so now you can ask yourself, are there maps other than the identity for which this new guy here is again an admissible model and satisfies again automatically all of these analytical bounds? And, well, you can basically characterize those linear maps for which this is true. So there are not that many of them, but there are, okay, it's still a finite parameter family of them. And it turns out that in our case, we essentially just need a two-parameter family of maps. Okay. And so in our case, the M that works is of the form exponential minus one constant times L1 minus another constant L2. So this is exponential just in the sense of matrix, right? This is a matrix. It's a finite dimensional vector space. But this is just exponential of a matrix. And where the operator L1 will be the thing it takes, so when you apply it to one of these graphs, it looks at all the occurrences of a subgraph of this type and removes them. So if you want L1, it takes, for example, that guy, and it maps it to just 1. So 1 is the one that comes from the Taylor polynomials, which is the x to the 0. Okay. And then whenever you have, so for example, if you have that guy, it maps it to 3 times this, right? Because this appears basically 3 times as a subgraph, and whenever you remove it, you have this guy left. Okay, and when you apply it to, for example, the other one, you know, say a more complicated one like this one, you would get, well, there are 3 ways of removing it at the top, where what's left is this. But then you could also remove it at the bottom. Which gives you this. Okay. And then there's no, so you only remove one, right? So the double removals are handled by the fact that it comes into the exponential. Okay, and the L2 is the one that removes every occurrences of this graph. Okay, so it maps this to one. And so it so the only other guy in which this one appears is this one. And so it maps this one, for example, into three times this, right? Because again, there are three ways in which this guy appears as a subgraph of this one, and then what's left is just one of these little bits. So these are these operations, L1 and L2. And well, there's a theorem, if you want, which says that these operations here don't destroy this whole structure. Okay, so if you build a new model in this way, it's if the old model was admissible, then the new one is admissible. If the old one was a model in the sense that it satisfies these analytical bounds, then the new one satisfies them as well. No, it doesn't. So the thing, OK, so so if you want, yeah, so it mixes things of different degree. That's true. So it doesn't respect, so it's, I mean, it has a kind of triangular structure, right? So you only get things of higher degrees. So it respects in that sense. It has some kind of triangular structure. But yes, it mixes things of different homogeneity. And that's the whole point, which is that, in a way, these constants end up, they blow up, and the speed at which they blow up is exactly to compensate for the difference in homogeneity, right? So this guy, it maps something of homogeneity, basically minus one, into something of homogeneity zero. And what this tells you is that this constant will blow up like one over epsilon. Whereas that guy maps this guy into something of homogeneity zero. And this guy, what homogeneity does it have? Well, it's a little bit, so this guy, it's a bit like the product of these two. Not quite, because one of these guys is downstairs, but that doesn't change the homogeneity. And so it has basically homogeneity zero, right? There's the minus kappa, which was just there because of some Kolmogorov type thing. So essentially here, it doesn't really change it. And that suggests, well, usually when things appear not to change, but they kind of change, you have logs showing up. Right? So here, that one diverges logarithmically. Okay. And so now the theorem is that, well, if you choose these constants in the right way, yeah, just finish this. So if you choose these constants in the right way, and there's a completely explicit formula for them, and then it agrees with what was known from the construction of 543. So if you choose these two constants in the right way, then, and you take for this guy just a mollification of space-time white noise, then the sequence of models that you obtain converges in probability to a limit. Okay? And the limit has a completely explicit description in terms of inner chaos decomposition. So you can just as well describe the limit immediately without having to refer to any kind of smoothing procedure. And that's what tells you that it doesn't depend on how you smoothen things out, right? Because you can actually straight, a priori, you can tell what the limit is. You can describe it in terms of its Wiener chaos decomposition. And then you just prove that things converge to it, whichever way you regularize them. So in dimension two, yes. So this is the one. This is the operation that corresponds to weak ordering. That's the weak ordering. And so in dimension two, you have only this guy, and this one diverges logarithmically. Exactly. Yeah. And so maybe let me just show you in a second to conclude how. You want to derive, you see, now you have the, you have built a model that converges, and now you would want to figure out what it actually did at the level of the equation, right? So let me just show you in a second how you do that, right? You would want to, because for the, so for the original model, because we had defined, right? We had defined pi of a for the canonical lift, we had defined pi of the product as product of the pi's, and as a consequence, it actually does the same thing at the level of the pi x's. And so for the canonical lift, you can show that it has the property that reconstruction operator applied to a product is product of the things where you apply the reconstruction operator, okay? And so there, you just apply the reconstruction operator on both sides of this identity, and you see that the solution of this, when you apply the reconstruction operator, just gives you a solution of the original PDE, right? Because you, here you pull it into the, so here there was the curly K, right? You pull it into the curly K, it gives you a convolution with the heat kernel, and then you have a reconstruction operator applied to phi cube, and because of the product being defined as the usual product, that just gives you the reconstruction operator applied to phi cubed, and then you just have the, you know, the Duhamel formulation of the original PDE, and here you just have xi, right? And so now, when you mess things up here, essentially the property that you end up breaking is the one that pi of a product is product of the pi's, okay? So you end up breaking this property. And these operators tell you exactly somehow by how much you actually break this property. Okay. So it turns out, and that's, okay, it's not a completely trivial fact, but it's true, that in all of these cases, pi x m tau of x is actually just pi x m tau of x. Okay, so we know. So we know how the reconstruction operator for the new model relates to the reconstruction operator of the old model, because this is all that appears. It's not true, okay, so this is in general not the same, okay? But if you evaluate here at the same point, which is exactly what you need for this reconstruction operator, then you get the same, okay? So you have a nice way of relating the renormalized one and the unrenormalized one. And now what you do is you plug, you say, you try to guess, or you just make an ansatz for the solution which you plug into this fixed point problem over and over again in order to get a formula for the form of the solution. Okay, so what you say is that phi, it's going to be, well, you see there's the I of xi that appears. So that's just that guy, which has homogeneity minus a half. And then there's going to be something in front of the one, which is the zero order term of the Taylor polynomial. And that one, I don't know what it is, right? That's the point of the fixed point problem, is to figure that out. And so I just give it a name. That's just some function phi. I don't know what it is, okay? But then it tells you that phi cube, there's going to be this guy, and there's going to be a 3 times this guy times phi, right? And there's going to be a 3 phi square times this guy, for example, in phi cube, okay? Which then tells you that in phi, you will have a minus this guy here, right? Which you come from integrating this up. And now, this in turn tells you that in the phi cube, you're going to have, for example, a minus 3 times this guy here times this guy, right, et cetera. Okay, so you can write down the form of the solution and the form of the right-hand side. And then what you see is that when you apply, so this is at the abstract level. So here, that's completely independent of the model, right? Whatever the model is, the solution is always going to be of this type. It's just that this function here depends on epsilon or depends on the model, okay? But the form of the solution is always going to be the same. Well, so no, there are actually some, there are more terms than the, right? But yes, there are finitely many. And then at some point, it becomes of positive homogeneity. And then things of positive homogeneity don't really influence what you get when you apply the reconstruction operator. And so you don't care about them exactly. Yeah. Right? So this is completely finite. Okay, it's not like a perturbative theory. It's a finite description of this object. Although it looks very much like a perturbative series, except for these guys here that are unknown functions. And then what you see is that when you apply, essentially when you apply this map M to the right-hand side, well, it's going to modify some of the terms. Okay? So it's going to have, so this term is going to be modified, this term is going to be modified, this term is going to be modified. Okay? And then what you end up seeing is that when you apply R to phi cube, the R corresponding to the renormalized model, it ends up being the R applied to phi cubed, and then plus correction. And when you go back and just compare the correction that you obtained from here with what you knew to be the description of phi, what you realize is that the correction term is exactly something like 3c1, and then I don't remember, it's plus or minus 9c2 times rm of phi itself. Okay, so you end up, and this is something that you see simply at the level of, you know, writing a few more terms here and then using the explicit form of M and just comparing terms. Okay, and there are just finitely many things to check. And you get this identity here. And that tells you that if you plug in one of these renormalized models, well, the equation that you were actually solving wasn't the one with a cube in the right-hand side, but with a cube minus this. Well, OK, so here it would be. No, so the so this guy, right? That depends on the little phi, right? And so, okay. But so here it turns out if you go through the calculation, you simply have these constants appearing, and that's it. Right. Yeah. So here it's a. So exactly, if you when you set up this fixed point problem here, it's exactly like. It basically turns into a usual PDE theory, right? And usual PDE theory, there's always sort of short time existence and then global existence. It's a completely different problem, or somehow knowing whether there is more than one stationary solution is a completely different problem from, you know, knowing that you have solutions. Okay. So. Oh, to just use it completely a priori without knowing anything about the. Right. So the only obstacle is that it's difficult to get a priori bounds on the solution. Right. In two dimensions, you can do it, yes. In two dimensions, there's no problem. Because in two dimensions, it's easier to get a priori bounds than in three dimensions. So in two dimensions, you can get bounds. And the so you can do exactly the same business, so you get local solutions. But then you can actually just get a priori bounds on the solution that don't depend on epsilon. So and they are also don't depend on time. So you can a priori get global bounds. And then once you have a priori global bounds, you get stationary solutions and so on. So there you have to use, to get the a priori bounds, you have to use the right sign. Exactly. Sure. Whereas here, even with the right sign, it's much more difficult to get a priori bounds on the solution. So, and that comes, it essentially, well, it's all due to this additional divergence. That's the one that also makes the calculations of, I mean, the kind of calculations you would want to do in order to get a priori bounds don't go through because of this additional divergence.
That term is meant to not absolutely
yeah, that's the term which is all the trouble. If you had only weak randomization, things would be much, much easier.